Well, I'm really glad I chose that prelude for today so my fingers could warm back up. I needed that. You've just heard the call to worship. It's 2:14 in your hymnal. Sing hallelujah to the Lord. Let's join together in singing it a couple of times.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord. Sing hallelujah to the Lord. Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
All right, you've heard it. Let's sing it out more the second time.
Praises, come thou fount of every blessing. 15 in your hymnal.
Please. Creator God, Spirit of Life, thank you for this cool, crisp morning that helps us to know that we are alive. Thank you for the beautiful sunrise. We thank you for your continued presence among us. We thank you for your healing love, and we thank you for the challenge of your word, the inspiration of your gospel, and the community of your church. Be present among us this morning, God. Refresh and renew us. Challenge us and change us in our worship, in our mission, and in our service. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, good morning and welcome to the worship, the cool worship of First Baptist Gainesville. We're so glad that you are here this morning, that you got up this morning, and you chose to be together in community with us. this week we have a few things that are beginning or sort of continuing, and those are a couple of Bible studies. First of all, we're doing the Growing Young series, and Pastor Jeremy is posting that online. You can look at it on our Facebook page, and you can also go to the website, fbcgainesville.org, and click on the Sunday devotions, and you can see that that Bible study posted. So if you'd like to join online, that would be a great thing to do. It's going to be very informative, and it's about how our church can be more welcoming, especially for young folks. Also beginning this week is the Ephesians study. If you're interested in it, Ephesians, it's building a community in Christ. Email me and I will get you the Zoom invite and I will get you a little booklet. So if you're interested in a Zoom Bible study, it's Wednesday nights from 7 to 8 p.m. Also this week is the FBC Bake Shop. You do not want to miss this. This is going to be a wonderful compilation of delectable delights that you want to get, especially as we get ready for the holiday season. So come Friday and Saturday. I think it starts from 10 o'clock on Friday, and I believe it starts maybe at 9 on Saturday. But come and purchase some pumpkin bread or cakes or cookies or cupcakes, and take those, and you can freeze them for your holiday dinners. But go ahead and do that. The proceeds will go to the Ministry of Caring. And this is a wonderful ministry because it helps folks out right now that are particularly in need, especially during this time. Anyhow, I want to welcome you. So if you would right now, maybe just glance across the aisles and wave to someone. Just say, welcome, glad you're here. Stay warm. And we will continue in our worship.
Some of the songs we sing in worship, we talk directly to God, just like, come thou fount of every blessing, tune our hearts to sing thy praise. Some songs we sing to each other, meant to teach each other and encourage each other. And that's the case of this next song, 476, be strong in the Lord and be of good courage. Let's sing it together.
Defender is always the same. My
Today's New Testament reading is Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 3, and then verse 8 through 16. Faith is the reality of what we have hoped for, the proof of what we don't see. The elders in the past were approved because they showed faith. By faith we understand that the universe has been created by a word from God, so that the visible came into existence from the invisible. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was going to receive as an inheritance. He went out without knowing where he was going. By faith, he lived in the land he had been promised as a stranger. He lived in tents along with Isaac and Jacob, who were co-heirs of the same promise. He was looking forward to a city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, even Sarah received the ability to have a child, though she herself was barren and past the age for having children, because she believed that the one who promised was faithful. So descendants were born from one man, and he was as good as dead. There were as many as the number of the stars in the sky, and as countless as the grains of sand on the seashore. All these people died in faith without receiving the promises, but they saw the promises from a distance and welcomed them. They confessed that they were strangers and immigrants on earth. People who say this kind of thing make it clear that they are looking for a homeland. If they had been thinking about the country they had left, they would have had the opportunity to return to it. But at this point in time, they are longing for a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God isn't ashamed to be called their God. He has prepared a city for them.
So Abraham moved onward, to borrow Bruce's word from last Sunday. He moved onward in faith, believing in God's promises. And that's what Scripture tells us, that all things are possible through God. Let's sing about this truth. It's 534 in your hymnal, Only Believe. We'll do it a couple of times. I know we got quite a few choir members out here, so please sing parts. These are beautiful harmonies in this. Take out your worship guide, look on the back of it, you'll find music to a new hymn called By Faith. We've sung this some in our 11 o'clock worship, but never out here, and I want us to know it. It's given to us by the modern hymn writers, Keith and Kristen Getty and Stuart Town, and they also gave us the hymn In Christ Alone that we've come to love so much. These are great words. When you think about the sermon you heard last week and the sermon you'll hear today, you'll understand why I've chosen it, but it's one I want us to know. So maybe after we sing it today, you just fold it up, put it in your hymnal, and keep it, and refer to it again in the future. Let's join together in singing it.
By faith we see the hand of God and the light. Prove his faithful. this mountain shall be moved, and the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible for all who call upon his name. We will stand.
Into the blue sky and see the possibilities. This morning, we remember those who are not able to look up into the blue sky. We think of those especially who are in the hospital. We think of T. Richard Davis and the many ways he has ministered to so, so many of us and people in many places. And we think of Mary Dobbs, who again has shown your love in so many ways. I pray that this morning they would especially feel that they are close to you, that you are their breath. And I pray that you would encourage them greatly. Oh Lord, there's so many that are awaiting procedures, and I pray that you would calm their fears and that you would help their doctors to give the best care possible. And then there are those that are in recovery. Lord, many have such a long way to go, and I pray that you would just give them perseverance, hope, just a steadfast faith, because you are a God of steadfast love and healing. Lord, we pray for ourselves. We pray for our country. We pray for our church. You have the whole world in your hands. And so we trust you. We pray that you would create in us clean hearts, O God. We join others all around the world this morning, and we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
I would like to invite you to turn to today's Old Testament reading and focus passage, which is Genesis chapter 15. We're going to read verses 1 through 6. After these events, the Lord's word came to Abram in a vision. Don't be afraid, Abram. I am your protector. Your reward will be very great. But Abram said, Lord God, what can you possibly give me since I have no children? The head of my household is Eleazar, a man from Damascus. He continued, since you haven't given me any children, the head of my household will be my heir. The Lord's word came immediately to him. This man will not be your heir. Your heir will definitely be your own biological child. Then he brought Abram outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars if you think you can count them. He continued, this is how many children you will have. Abram trusted the Lord, and the Lord recognized Abram's high moral character as righteousness. If I use too many sports analogies, please issue a complaint in the sermon complaint box in the office. Valerie has sometimes told me I lean way too much on sports examples, which maybe I do, but here we go. Back in the 1980s, the Louisville Cardinals were about to shut down their football program. I know you Georgia fans are thinking, oh, how cute. They're about to shut it down because they weren't winning. They weren't drawing fans. It just wasn't a good program. But a coach came on the scene named Howard Schnellenberger, who also coached at Miami and Oklahoma, and had a vision for the football program, a vision of winning and new buildings and larger coaching staffs and more fans and larger stadiums. He was a large, gruff man with a mustache who walked around with a pipe in his mouth. And in the late 1980s, and I'm going to do my best Howard Schnellenberger impression, he said, "We're on a collision course with the national championship. The only variable is time," is what he said. Oh, stop. He wanted to put the pieces in place to become a national championship contender, this independent football team that was at that time not a part of a conference and who was considering shutting their program down. And so slowly over those 30 years, the pieces have been put in place to become, or at least pursue, the dream of becoming a national championship contender. New facilities, part of a better conference, hopefully getting better recruits. Now, if you're watching ABC last night between the hours of 7:30 and 11, you would say, that timeline just got a little longer, didn't it? Because Louisville lost by about 20 points last night. Some of us aren't holding our breath. Louisville may never get there, who knows. But some of us, and I like to count myself as one of these, are keeping our hopes alive that maybe, just maybe, the Louisville Cardinals football team is still on a collision course with the national championship, and the only variable is time. We'll see about that. But life is so often full of unfulfilled dreams. It may be a sports team that has yet to win a pennant or a championship. It may be your dream job or career that you're waiting to come to fruition or to be offered to you. It may be a certain net worth that you're hoping to reach in order to retire or to have some money left to give to your children. It may be a certain policy change or a piece of legislation that you've been waiting for and waiting for and waiting for and feel that we'll never get there. Even now, we are at a major crisis point in our country's history, and we ask ourselves, God, are we going to get through this in one piece? I don't think that there's any question that our world will still be here in a year or two when we consider this over. But we ask ourselves, are we going to get through this? Is there a promise to be delivered at the end of this pandemic? I still remember back on about March the 15th at First Baptist Church of Black Mountain when we knew we had to call off our services like all the other churches were doing. And I remember we called it off for 2 weeks because maybe in 2 weeks we'll be able to gather again. And then we called it off for another 2 weeks because maybe a month is all we would need to get through this. And then by the time I started here, those cancellations had become indefinite. But in my mind, I thought, that's okay. By October, we'll probably all be back to normal. Catherine Schifferdecker said, present reality has a way of overwhelming future hope. Is there someone or some story we can look to in the scripture that involves someone who is just waiting for something good to happen? Who is just waiting for a promise to be fulfilled, waiting for the good ending or the breaking in of God's blessing? Is there someone in the scripture who struggles with the very same doubts and uncertainties that we do who sit here today? And yet that person preserves and chooses the path of faith. Today we catch up on the story and arrive in the life of Abram. Yes, we have passed several major stories in God's story. We had the creation the first week. Since that time, we've had the story of Cain and Abel, the flood and the Tower of Babel, which I would encourage you to go back and to read, even though we won't be hitting on those this morning. The story has transitioned from establishing order on the earth and taking a bigger look at humanity and our fallenness and continued rebellion, our continued desire to play God and to have lordship over each other, not just between individuals, but also entire people groups. And so we arrive at Genesis 15 today, but it's also important to consider Genesis 12, where the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." And so that is what brings us to today's story. We hone in on a family of Abram and Sarai, who go to a distant land in order to make a great nation. The trajectory of God's story is now directed through one family. And through much of Genesis, we follow this family's story. And so today we arrive at Genesis 15, years after Abram is sent, years after God promises a great blessing and a great nation. God comes to Abram in a vision and says, "Do not be afraid," which is an indication of good news. About any time you open up the scripture and some messenger or God or an angel says, "Do not be afraid," you can know good news is on the way. But Abram didn't quite have that insight that we have in looking through the scriptures, because understandably, Abram ultimately says, "God, what kind of good news can you offer me? What kind of good news do you possibly have to give me today?" Abram says, "I'm childless, I'm getting old, you promised us a great nation, and here we are. You said I would have children and form a great nation. Did I miss something? Have I misinterpreted your promise? Lord, it's not happening, we're running out of time." God assures Abram that he will keep the promise and give Abram descendants. And God says, "Not only am I going to keep that promise, but look up at the sky. Look at the number of stars in the sky. That is the future picture of your descendants. If you can count all the stars in the sky, if you could possibly count that many, that is the number of your descendants. God says, "I am holding on to this promise, as should you." The most important line in today's passage: Abram believed the Lord, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Today's scripture is in many ways a microcosm of our faith journey, isn't it? It reveals the struggles of a biblical hero, Father Abraham. We have songs about Father Abraham. Father Abraham had many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham. I am one of them, and so are you. So let's just praise the Lord, right? Abraham is a biblical hero, and yet we find Abram in a moment of doubt and struggle. We sing about Abram. Abram is quoted later in the story and is mentioned later in the story, and yet he has a moment of expressed doubt before God. But in the same vision or conversation or prayer, he places his ultimate faith and trust in God, still not knowing exactly how things are going to play out. Not because he's been given some vision or picture of how it will play out, but because of a beautiful assuredness from his Creator. The scripture says it was in Abram's faith that he was made righteous and revealed his moral character. Not something Abram did, but because of his faith. his enduring faith. If we move ahead in the story to Romans 4, Paul is explaining what makes one righteous before God. He's deconstructing this notion that there's a special lineage, or that you can be born into the faith and that's good enough. Paul says that faith is the path to righteousness. Paul says, what does the scripture say? Abraham had faith in God and it was credited to him as righteousness. The scripture says that it was credited to him, wasn't written only for Abraham's sake, by the way. Paul says this. He said, this isn't just for Abraham. He said it was also written for our sake because it is going to be credited to us too. It will be credited to those of us who have faith in the one who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. The story of Abram and his faith journey was written for us. Faith is not a mere New Testament concept or a Pauline concept. Faith is at the heart of the story of God's people from cover to cover. Ultimately, God's plan for us all along is that we would be people of great faith, that we would trust in God's promise to protect us and bring us through life's challenges. Our path to overcoming the fall of humankind that we read about last week is to trust in God's promise and to receive the gift of grace through faith. And as Christians, our faith is placed in the central character of the story, Jesus Christ. The central character gives us a perspective that Abram did not have. Now, we believe that the Son is eternally present, but Abram did not know Jesus, but Abram was a man of faith. And God's promise to bless the nations found its ultimate fulfillment in Christ Jesus, whose life, death, and resurrection makes salvation possible for all. We know that because when we have a glimpse of the end of the story in Revelation 7, and John is given a vision of heaven, he says, there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, just like the stars that Abram gazed upon in Genesis 15. From every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. The promise given to Abram, we can see, is fulfilled. It is fulfilled in ways bigger than we thought possible. And that promise will reach its ultimate fulfillment at the conclusion of the story. So what lessons can we take from this small portion, only a few verses, of Abram's story? I'm going to wait for the siren to pass. Let's say a prayer for wherever they're going. What can we take from Abram's story? Faith is a struggle. It's an interesting lesson to take from the story of Abram, that faith is a struggle. Doesn't mean that faith is useless or incomplete, but faith can be a struggle. As we move through God's story, every week we're going to see it. Don't just think that every week each passage is going to be kind of an easy theological truth. It's a struggle every week of the story. Yet choosing faith and trusting God is never absent from the story. Every week we will revisit this particular concept of placing our faith and trust in God. And God understands that struggle and invites us to struggle with Him. You'll notice that God didn't dismiss Abram or call him foolish or say, "You of little faith." God understood the struggle that Abram had. and invites him to trust. First Baptist Church, we must serve as a congregation who is open and invites people into our midst who struggle in the faith. That's not just non-believers or unchurched people who are looking for answers or who are seeking truth. That's true of us here today as well. We may have placed our faith in Jesus Christ. That does not mean that we still don't have struggles in our faith, daily or weekly. And so may this place, may this congregation be a place we can come to in the same manner as Abram and express our doubts and say, God, where are you in all of this? May this place be a place of hospitality in the name of Jesus that invites the most difficult, challenging questions of our faith. I pray we will be hospitable to everyone as God was to Abram in this passage. We also must learn that God's promise often plays out differently than we first dream or imagined. Abram may have had a timeline in his mind when God first gave the promise to Abram that he would bear many children and be the father of many nations. Abram may have said, okay, probably 5 years from now, that'll at least be partly true. 10 years, it'll probably be. Abram may have been playing out a timeline in his mind, and so we should also be cautious not to instill our own timelines on God's plan. Our stories will often play out differently than we imagine. In fact, I'd say most of the time they will play out differently than we imagine. That is the truth of answering God's call on our lives. When we are called of God, we are called simply to place our trust in Him and to follow that call through location or through career or through time. What we can know and trust is that no matter what our careers look like, no matter what our family situations look like, our financial situations, our context, where we move or where we relocate to, what we can know and trust is the promise to experience joy, peace, and love in Christ wherever that call takes us. And then finally, I believe our challenge for today is to choose faith. Abram chose faith in this passage. You see, God didn't put Abram in a trance where all of a sudden he was righteous and moral and a person of faith. Abram chose faith. Faith is not a mindset that drops into our consciousness or in our hearts at any given moment. It is a profession of faith, after all, that we make, isn't it? We make a profession of faith when we choose to become followers of Jesus Christ, but we also choose faith daily. Daily, we choose to place our trust in the crucified and risen Savior. We trust in God's promise to usher in this new creation, whatever today, whatever this week looks like. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. I believe that faith is acknowledging that you are on a collision course with the redemptive ending of God's story, and trusting in that reality here and now, and sharing it with others with whom you encounter. I want to end by reciting the words of this new hymn that we heard Mark sing just prior to the sermon time. It's one that we'll revisit throughout the year. It is a hymn that in many ways is a celebration of this promise, and the promise that finds its ultimate conclusion in the person of Jesus Christ. The words are, we will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. May it be so. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you as children of the promise, reflecting on the story of Abram.
and given our thanks to you for inviting us into this story. When we have doubts, we are thankful for your hospitality and welcoming us as we are. But Lord, as we express our doubts, may we daily choose faith. In the midst of uncertainty, may we choose Jesus. And may we take that message to the world around us in the same way that Abram was to be a blessing, and that the nation that would come from that would be a blessing to all. May we see ourselves in that role, to be a blessing to our neighbor through the person of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Our hymn of response is 411. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Let's sing together stanzas 1 and 2.
So much for joining us for worship today on this chilly morning. I would like to make a couple of quick announcements before we head out today. First of all, after hearing some feedback and discussing as a staff, you know, we started this service at 8 a.m. because of the sweltering summer heat, and it looks like the sweltering summer heat may be on its way out. I'm guessing it may be a little, I've already looked ahead to next week. The low is only supposed to be in the 60s next Sunday. All that being said, we have agreed to beginning the first Sunday in October to begin our worship service at 9 a.m. as opposed to 8 a.m. Okay, so beginning the first Sunday of October, our outdoor worship will begin at 9 a.m. We will send you reminders to make sure that you know that. But we really don't need to be meeting at 8 o'clock anymore just for the sake of avoiding the heat. It looks like we're going to be okay at 9 a.m. But just be paying attention for some more details there. And we will be, once again, that's not next week. That's beginning the first Sunday in October. So just keep that in mind.
Can I get an amen?
Yes, amen, absolutely. I heard a couple of people start to applause, and you keep on keeping on. It's your amens, applause are all good. So, once again, first week in October is when we will move this service to 9 a.m. We also want to thank you for your continued support of First Baptist Church, as always. Even through challenging seasons, we're so thankful that you participate in the life of this congregation, not just with your presence, but also with your resources in supporting our ministry. So if you feel led to give to the ministry and mission of First Baptist Church, you'll see offering baskets at the front that you are welcome to give to. There's a secure box in our south portico that you can drop offering into. You can also give online, however you prefer. We welcome that and thank you for that. And so once again, we're so glad to have all of you worshiping with us today. At this time, if you would receive this benediction, we'll then be dismissed. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Go in peace. Amen.